I'm a quality manager in Finland in BPS, in private hosting service provider. Hosted parents, we have hosted parents and supported placement and supported placements. That's our work in Finland. And we are part of the Assets group, so you may notice this logo here. And I'm a quality manager in data social worker and kind of work. I'm Hugin and Anne. When the IFCO conference put all the presentations in their website, you may get also this presentation. And I just want to say to you that here are four pages resources. And when I tell you about these things, there are some numbers to get resources and get all these afterwards, I hope. So, let's start then. I come from Finland. We have thousands of lakes and forests. You may know maybe this photo tells you something about the belief. And some of these things what I tell you today is maybe just like being aware of the good benefits we have from ecosystems and natural environment, and then after that how to more better use them and benefit from them and also provide them. And now we all here maybe want to promote holistic care for children. I think we all want to do that. But if we think holistic care, do we include ecological work in it nowadays? Do we something with that? Do we have our sight on that? And today I think that more than ever we know that we should do. But the big question is maybe how to do it. And today, what I tell you and show you, maybe we find some ways to do it from this also. And one way to do it and start is take a look of the many studies that we have nowadays. What tells us about the good benefits that we get from nature. We have, for example, research on health benefits like this, that nature is very vibrant in environment. It reduces stress by lowering the amount of stress hormone called cortisol. It increases emotional well-being and using anxiety, improving mood, lowers blood pressure and heart rate. This kind of physiological benefits we have on it, and we have research on that. This is happening. Also, white blood cells increases after spending time in natural environment. It activates the parasympathetic nervous system and it makes us feel like more relaxed. Being a learning environment helps cognitive and social development. We have some research on that. It helps in development of motor skills, activates and strengthens senses. Helps with concentration, creative activities, and even 20 minutes spending in nature is this kind of good benefit for you. And of course, when we are dealing with children, we can just imagine that how we could better use this. And then it is also as a child in care and child protection needs. wonder that what, why this is happening. And we may not have exact reason to say that this is the reason why it happens, but there is, for example, this kind of idea of hypothesis that says that our, we as humans, we had spent our living time just for some hundreds of years in cities. All of our history has been in a natural world, so our mind and body has adapted to natural environment. And even now today, because it's more natural for us in a way, or our mind and body will be there, then we reach there, also our mind and body will be more stable. And that might be one reason for these good results of the research tells us. And all the good benefits that we found out for the natural environment, we in PK's practice, the 2016, we wanted to do some experiments on that. We had this kind of 10-year of natural well-being. We had different kind of practice with foster carers and children and stuff, and try to learn about this, how to use, how to benefit. Here are some photos having some experiments with children and stuff, and then I made this kind of folder, a lot of information in it about these benefits and so on. And in a way, we didn't just target on. Target on this kind of relaxation and that kind of things. Like we might be also find the ways how to do that kind of experiments that we could target in. Kind of personal developmental goals what some children has had. And now I want to go a little deeper because this presentation is also about sustainable well-being and sustainability. And when we think about health and well-being and how it is related in natural environment, I think we should realize more better that all the benefits that we get, but also how our whole life depends on natural environment and the ecosystem services that it provides us. And when we have this nature and well-being here, we are dealing mostly with these cultural ecosystem services. But at the same time, we get aware of these other and try to more better increase our awareness that we are dependent of regulation. Provisioning and supporting services. Of course, we didn't deal with this directly children. It was more like inside staff and maybe carers, but that was one start to, for example, show this also to carers, like give them always. And of course, also us have a lot of to do in coming days also. And you realize that this is so important that we gave this kind of commitment on sustainable development. And with that commitment, we committed on learning and strengthen the connection with nature and achieve more better understanding and importance of ecosystem services and sustainable development also. And of course, all these other health benefits of what is as well. And here is the link for this. How many of you have heard these sustainable developmental goals? Yeah. In Finland, there are now quite a lot, these are universal, as you may know. But for example, in Finland, today, all the organizations from private to third sector and public should try to adapt these. And of course, it's quite difficult to start if you have not dealt with this kind of things. So during our work and this 10 years, we also managed to create some ways to improve also these and promote these. And here you can. There is this time when we did also promote these sustainable developmental goals. And in a way, these sustainable developmental goals, if we think those goals, often you see these like this. But actually, if you think more better, they should be like this, because our social environment and economical environment couldn't be without good ecological environment. If we lose this, it makes very much difficulties for our social environment, for children and young people, families, their being, and of course, economic. Maybe can't stand that situation either. So, if we want to promote a good social environment, we should also, in a way, take care of this. So, yeah, as we can. In Finland, Tuuli Hirvilammi, doctor in social sciences, has done some work, and actually her doctoral thesis on sustainable well-being. And I have tried to adapt quite a lot about the thinking of her, and some of this thinking that we did today is about her doctoral thesis. And some main messages are that we should try to keep our well-being with planetary boundaries. And of course, it's maybe in that space quite a lot like thinking about our consumption and that kind of things. It's kind of way we get our well-being. And I think that in fostering world here today and tomorrow and in this conference, we deal maybe quite a lot about this kind of well-being, that this what are relational and it's between people and how to get that kind of well-being raised and also intrigued like sustainability things. It is possible. But in today, our approach today for in well-being is quite this kind of humanistic way to see. But this tool here, Lami, for example, want to promote this kind of idea of relational human understanding. and it is that you should include the environment, the ecological environment in your human understanding. And actually see that our well-being can't start without a well-functioning environment and ecosystems. And I myself have tried to fit these ideas in a child protection world. And I write this article of sustainable well-being and social work with children, promoting our connectedness with nature through nature-assisted interventions. It was published this year in IFSW, in our book. So you can get this free from the web. I'm not just by what I'm thinking this. This is important. Our society in Finland is thinking that this is important. Actually, last year we gave from our government this kind of acknowledge of promoting sustainable well-being, and I think that was quite sure feedback for us. So let's do it more. And then all the good benefits that we have from the environment. I think we all know the two sides of the same coin at the moment. We are wondering and seeing, are we losing the good benefits? Are we losing this stability of the environment that we are depending on? And I think it's quite a crucial thing to do, and also we as social worker and healthcare worker can do, I think, quite a lot with that. Because of our children, young people, and families, and because of well-being. And for example, Lusak is saying and seeing that social work has quite good talents to deal with these things. We can deal with loss, attachment, reconnection, that kind of things. How can we use these talents for these things also? It's not like just that, but I think we have good opportunities to develop our practice as we want. And climate change and children. I'm very happy that UN Convention of the Rights of the Child has done something with this. But I realize that we as workers, developers, we don't know this yet. And that's really sad, and that's why I'm telling for you today, for example, about this. This is important. And actually, climate change is our rights of the child. Many of them are danger for this. And of course, it's not just our task as workers in the field to do something for that, but the governments should do, and the people who are developing services in societies, and of course every of us can try to influence on that this development could start more heavily. And because of our children here in IFCO conference, we are dealing with children who are very vulnerable. Of course, I think this is one worry for us, what to do. And I have no exact answers, but one answer is that we should start to deal with this thing and think it better. And we know that sustainable way of life is the target that we should go to us. And actually, one way is to start to try to seek the ways how to try to promote this and help the families and children also adapt this kind of approach and way of living. How to connect with the nature more better. How to build confidence in these circumstances in the future. I think that's one big question for us. How to keep the children physically and emotionally safe? Quite huge question for us. Why don't we act? One big guy is one of my contacts. He is doing research in Finland of the eco-anxiety. And eco-anxiety, what we have in our societies, might be one huge reason why we don't act at the moment enough. Of course, our societies, those who are responsible for the development of our practices should do more with that. After that, we here in the field will have more opportunities to support families and children and young people like we should. And of course, we have in our societies quite a lot of denial, disavowal, social constructive science, and our social cues and social norms at the moment don't like us enough with this thing. And one thing that Van Vika is pointing that, of course, all this what we are today here also discussing has a lot of to do with tragedy. But we can't have just tragedy or just hope. We should have hope. But if we just have the hope and don't see the actual situation, that isn't a good step for one also we should have hope. And of course with children and young people we should also always point this hope. We should see we ourselves should see all the good progress at the moment what we have and what we can do. And I'm actually little worried about that we have not today enough examples given to our children and young people about the possibilities to act and how we as adults are trying to do with these things. So if we have more examples, then I think that anxiety also and also, we should understand better human mind. I think that nowadays in societies, when we try to push this sustainability path going on, we don't understand human mind at the moment enough well. We should try to seek more better ways to act. What has the idea of human mind also. But where did that begin then? Avoiding discussion and closing eyes isn't the answer. I think that first step is to start to think. I think quite many of us don't think this. Try to avoid thinking. But how to be, have the courage to start to think? Be aware of the feelings, what this raises. Discuss together, ask questions. Try to network, do networks, do planning. We should start to do discussion and development with these issues, or we lose this battle. This maybe looks like this like huge issue, and it is, but step by step we reach the goals. And eco-social work has done quite a lot with this thing. There are quite a lot of things that has already happened in social work with these things. And we can benefit from them and start to our development, our work from this stage. And us as social workers, I say us like I'm from social work world, social work professional. We can try to start to connect also our clients and as a profession with the natural world. Be aware of these things, all the health benefits, our people, clients, families, young people and children have from nature, and try to provide, because of that, try to provide them these benefits for them and also for next generation. Here is one example in our young people camp, we are planting the tree. This is quite common, this kind of experiment, what to do with children, plant a tree. You learn quite a lot about ecosystems and about doing this, and about the health benefits. Here is huge opportunity for common cooperation also. This promotes also that kind of developmental goals, not just health benefits. So, if you want to promote cooperation with young people and try to also at the same time read some approach for this natural thinking, you can do this kind of practice. We have, for example, research that says that soil has this kind of antidepressant bacteria in it. So having hands in soil gives you this kind of antidepressant effect. So it is many way good practice, for example, this kind of. And you can include, if having this kind of practice with children, young people, maybe also with families, you can include in it different kind of, like this kind of symbolic thinking also. For example, planting an apple tree like we did. It was the family apple tree, and family apple tree is that kind of tree. That there should always be a different species apple tree included. And I think it's for having apples and being flowering. So I think there was good symbolic opportunity to include this kind of fostering ideas in this practice also. And we also have some practice with our young people in young people camp, where we were thinking about what kind of is good planet, what kind of is bad planet, and what we could do it, and what our we as adults should do it. So research that tells us that different kind of studies that our young people, youngsters, they are thinking these things, but we as adults, we are not touching them. So we should find some ways to do it. And I was talking to you what we have done in PKS. We are part of Key Assets Club. And I was so happy that this Key Assets Club, what is operating in 9 countries, get this year this kind of sustainability policy. Also, what are linking the health and well-being of children and young people with the ecological stability and how to promote it. So I think that we all can do it. It's just find the ways how to do it. And I hope that today I have given you some tips where you might start. And thank you very much.